So welcome everyone. I'm really pleased that in the really sunny months of August, still so many people join here at the user group. I think this is fantastic. And I hope that you are as keen on what software craftsmanship is as me. And today I want to take you on a tour about it. But first a little recap. So this year I had the opportunity to travel and I was among other conferences invited to Vox Days CERN. So as you can see, it's a big, big circle. Maybe everyone already knows what it is. Yes, the Super Collider. And besides the conference, I even had the opportunity to go deep into Earth, 100 meters below ground, and there see the biggest machine on Earth. And it's producing a massive amount of data. And I was not there alone, but with me was a very influential guy in software craftsmanship, Uncle Bob. Maybe some of you have heard about him. And we were visiting actually the Super Collider together, which was a fun experience. But why do I talk about the Super Collider? It produces a massive amount of data, and today the world is changing very fastly, and we have to deal with it. And we have to deal with it with all our knowledge, with all our crafting. And in the community, there is always some debate how it should be called. So from the historic background, it's called software craftsmanship. But nowadays, we are more aware about gendering, and therefore, it sometimes also is called craft or software craft, just to be more inclusive. In general, there was some debate. Also, some books have been released quite in the recent years. For example, Java by example. And there was also some debate on Twitter. And just from my perspective and also from Sandra Pasik's perspective, with whom I created this presentation together and which we gave at some conferences, craftsmanship is the historic naming. And if you are part of a community, the community should decide how it wants to name itself. So just so that you are aware, I will talk in the presentation a lot about craftsmanship. But if you are more comfortable with crafting or craft, this is also fine, and I highly embrace it, just so that you know the reason. And in the community where I'm active in, we are currently naming it craftsmanship. So, if you have so much data, for example, the LHC Super Collider produces 1 terabyte of data within only a few minutes. And this amount of data that you want to handle, we have to deal with it in a really proficient way. And that's the reason why, for example, we came up with Clean Code. So what was funny when I was visiting the Super Collider was that you, of course, could get at the souvenir shop a nice magnetic band with a lot of data that you could explore if you have, of course, the specific reading material at home. And also what was interesting is when they found something really cool, which, for example, the Higgs boson was, then they opened a bottle of champagne and celebrated it. Sometimes even the name is still there on the bottles and you can see them still in the big monitoring room. So the idea is if you create clean code, and you fix something that you also celebrate. Maybe not with a bottle of wine, but in the end that you feel some kind of satisfaction. That's what drives us forward. So with that introduction, I want to go along what I want to talk about with you today. So in the first part, I want to outline the history of craftsmanship. Where does it come from? Why do we need it? What has been done in the past and how do we get now to the current state and what is the current state. After that, I want to dive into a bit what is a dojo or coding dojo and coding kata, and also what katas are there, what types of katas exist, and then what can you do with them. In the end, to make it a bit smooth, I want to highlight a bit of the principles that are devoted to producing clean code. So to mention, I already said Sandra was really helpful in the past years where we created this. And besides that, I also was talking with two other fellows. So Sandra is from Software Craftsmanship Ruhrgebiet, and Marco is from Software Craftsmanship community in Nuremberg, and David from Munich. And I was also in exchange with them, or we were in exchange with them on the contents, just to give it the round picture. So why am I passionate about craftsmanship? So the history was that I was living in Munich and had a project in Nuremberg and visited two craftsmanship communities. And besides that, also went to a bigger conference. Then I moved to Thuringia, and there actually no craftsmanship community was established. And I also realized when I got into a bigger project that often we didn't do pair programming, we were not so aware of TDD, and so I wanted to create a space where we could practice this. And therefore I founded 3 years ago approximately a craftsmanship community in Thuringia. And since then I moved from one company to another and currently work at a company called CodeCentric, with also a nice topic called Clean Code Dirty Mind, which fits quite well to the craftsmanship community aspects. And we do regular meetups, and I will tell you more about it later. Besides that, I run some conferences and speak at several ones, also internationally. So, about the history. First, when you go to university, you have the feeling or the intention, okay, software engineering is a discipline, which is engineering. But actually, already in 1992, it was obvious for the first, or there was the first mention that software development actually is a combination of three things. One is engineering, the other one is craft, and the last part is research. And this first notion has been established throughout the history, and nowadays a lot of engineers perceive software development as a consistency of these three things. I will give more examples on this a bit later, and just that you know, Jack Rees was in 1992 the first one that mentioned it, but there was nothing besides it until Andrew Hunt and David Thomas came up with the first book, which is called The Pragmatic Programmer. Maybe some of you have heard about it. And there they talk from the journeyman to the master, a story, how you could evolve your skills. A bit more deeper was then the book Software Craftsmanship, which came out, I think, 1 year later by Pete McBreen. And there were mentions about software factories for automating software development, which was already an idea in 1990. But as we know, this didn't work out. And then they proclaimed that engineering should be a craft, which should be learned, and you should evolve in several steps. And there was a lot of debate about it. But then there was another conference, and this conference was more focusing on Agile. And the outcome here was the manifesto for agile software development. It was really important, and a lot of you may know the manifesto for agile software development, and a lot of the statements there, they helped, or there were 30 people coming together that were driving different ideas like Scrum and also other principles, and they wanted to create something like a framework, but they had a lot of project experience, and when they came up with the Agile Manifesto, it was so mind-blowing for everyone that it was present throughout the industry. So in the background, the term of craftsmanship or software crafting as such was not so predominantly anymore. So for several years, the Agile Manifesto and all the new techniques and methods dominated the market. What's the contents here? When we look at it, it's quite something that is really beneficial. So I will just go into the four core values because they are also important for craftsmanship later on. So first one is individuals and interactions are more important over processes and tools. So it's shifting from a technical thing like engineering to also something where you deal more with humans. And besides that, also the working software is more important than comprehensive documentation. When we go back in time, maybe a lot of you also, when they are in bigger companies, still deal with it. There was already several processes like waterfall or the rational unified process, where you produce a lot of artifacts with a lot of documentary around software. And the focus was there clearly spreading away from producing that kind of waste towards a working software that can be delivered to a customer. The problem at the time was that all projects nearly failed, and if they didn't fail, they were really postponed and delayed a lot. So the focus was how can we get into a faster release cycle or in iterations. At that time, iterations were also not so common, of course. And then another point was, of course, that customer collaboration is much more important for the success of a project than something that is written in a contract where you negotiate about it. And besides that, when something is changing during the iterations, you adapt your plan. So therefore, responding to change is much more important than following over a plan. Yeah. Besides Scrum, also XP already was predominant in a lot of parts of the industry. It was also including some core principles that we also use in craftsmanship, like pair programming, for example. But overall, the main focus was the project process. So getting stronger, a better process with more output. And nobody at the time thought so much about technical excellence. At that time, a lot of companies that adopted to Scrum and benefited from it, they evolved the framework in a way that, for example, they had much more sticky notes, different kinds of colors for certain things, for the post-its, and they introduced dailies and so on. I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with it. But still, this went on for several years, and the projects still were not a lot more successful. And then at the time of 2008, at the Agile conference, Uncle Bob was invited to give a keynote. Also afterwards, he came out with the book, Clean Code. But at the keynote, he was talking that the Agile Manifesto as such is not enough, and he wanted to add another principle. He called it craftsmanship over crap. Later, of course, he transformed it to a bit more sophisticated or more elaborated notion, like craftsmanship over execution. But this expressed how a lot of the people felt at a time that still it was not so clear for a lot of people how to develop software. Let's stay on this a bit. Before we now come to the next evolutionary step, in the meantime, what happened besides the evolution of the Agile Manifesto was that we had already some summits on software apprenticeship. And on the Software Apprenticeship Summit, which was at 2002, where there are a lot of ideas already coming up about craftsmanship, several companies, like the one of Uncle Bob, and also 8Light, which was quite new and just founded, and also another company, which was where one person of 8Light transitioned from 8Light to the other company. So these three companies, they already agreed on the ideas of crafting and also apprenticeship. And therefore, these were the first three companies which introduced the concept of apprenticeship, and they offered new applicants the role of becoming an apprentice. So, but these were the only three companies. Also, what they did was sometimes exchanging already craftsmen, like craftsmanship swaps, but this was really a niche market and nobody was really aware of it. And they were also in a phase where they were experimenting a lot. But besides that, this summit in 2002 had no bigger outcome. So in 2008, besides this Agile conference, where the keynote with Uncle Bob happened, there was the first software craftsmanship summit. And there was a session from Mika Martin, and he invited a lot of people. It was happening, the whole conference, just in one day, 6 hours with 30 people only. And what Mika Martin was so feeling sorry about was that there was de facto no real outcome of the Software Apprenticeship Summit. I will just start at 2008. So Mika Martin was really sorry about that there was no outcome at the Software Apprenticeship Summit. And then at his session that he held, there were so many cool ideas, and there were quite some participants that they had a huge whiteboard which was filled with ideas. What is software craftsmanship? What does a software craftsman need to be a software craftsman? What are the skills? And what is so important? Why do we need it? And also, they talked about if they should come up with some written document already and proclaim it, but it was not so clear. And Mika Martin was the one that pushed it, and he already said, okay, we cannot come up with a really proper phrasing currently. There is too much currently which is on the whiteboard, but please, if you support all the ideas or want to push it forward, sign it. And therefore, the initial ideas that later ended in the Craftsmanship Manifesto were signed. To push it a bit forward, then Truck Bradbury took this whiteboard, all the ideas, and put it in the Software Craftsmanship Google group. And in that chat group or news group, he also wrote a short article called The New Left Side. As you know from the software, the Agile Manifesto, there was the left and the right side, right? And he talked about what should be now the new values that stand on the left side. And later on, Scott Pfister followed along with an article about the right side revisited. It was not really clearly phrased, and then Truck Bradbury decided to put it together, and he came up with the manifesto for software craftsmanship. Why do we need such a manifesto? There were several points made, and the first one is, yeah, we should have a vocal community. When you want to exist as such, we need to spread the word. When we want to push something forward, we should create visibility. And also, we should get more mature than just having a whiteboard with some ideas. We should establish some principles. And further along, of course, we should provoke it and develop some kind of schools. And the idea was that the software world is constantly changing, especially at that time and still is. So we get a lot of new engineers that are coming from the university. They learn all the things there in the engineering part, but they have not that experience in creating larger software systems. And therefore, it is nice for them to have some more guidance that helps them to develop fastly when they enter the market. So these ideas why we should have it were proclaimed by Corey Haynes mostly. So these are really familiar names in the craftsmanship world because he was also one of the first ones and later on also pushed an idea that I will talk about in a few minutes. When we now revisit the software, the Agile Manifesto, then we see that there were four statements made, and these four statements now were just enhanced. So, for example, the first statement now is not only working software, but also well-crafted software. So, direct reference, in the other manifesto, it was working software over comprehensive documentation, as you remember. And here, they are thinking, okay, they produced more working code, but it was not clear that there was not technical depth that was built up, and that it was easy to change, and that it was adaptive, and so on. And therefore, the code needs to be good to read and also well-crafted. Another statement that was made, what was important, was that they should not just only respond to change, but you should also constantly add value. This also refers a bit, or you can remember the Boy Scout rule, when you go to a place and then you should leave it nicer as it was before. So you should clean up the waste, and this is also what the craftsmanship in his mind should have. So if he works on a certain ticket, for example, and codes on it, and he dives into and there finds some things that are not maybe that proper, he should fix it along the way and therefore add and improve the value of the software. We see it often nowadays when we introduce new libraries, when you have all these cool new microservices, we come up with new things and then we think, okay, now we add, for example, Helm, a templating engine or whatever. And we do not want to spread it all around the ecosystem. But we introduce it steadily, and then when we maybe have a ticket on another service, we could push it to the same level as the others and therefore add value besides fixing or adding the actual feature. And this is what is meant here. Another point is not only individuals and interactions that count and that are important, where we should focus on, but we should also create a community of professionals. So what is a community of professionals? It could be that you come together like here, like in a user group. At that time, there already have existed one, but also within your company. you should create a space where you can exchange and learn and where you are free from the pressure of the project, so that you can have a good climate where you connect with each others and therefore spread the ideas so that not so many things get lost and that you don't create knowledge silos. At that time, this was not so clear. So there was a lot of pressure and the world was moving fast. Still is, I think. And besides that, when you think about our customers, we should not only collaborate with the customers, but over the contract negotiation, but also build productive partnerships so that it is a win-win situation for everyone. And these are the new guidelines as they thought that a new craftsman should have in if they establish this within a whole company, the project success and the revenue and therefore salaries and so on and what's all going beneficial for everyone should improve a lot. The Software Craftsmanship Manifesto is still online. You can sign it, so feel free. And I think there are thousands of people who already did it. And this was in 2009, so over 10 years ago. Then a lot of things have proceeded. So we had a lot of conferences and in London, Sandro Mancuso is living and he put a lot of the ideas that happened in the conferences or also in his company that he founded and it is developing quite well so far into a new book. And I think this is the last really recognizable outstanding book that you should read is The Software Craftsman. It's also part about the history, but besides that, he goes into new topics as well. So also, when you think about, I need new people in my team, how can I do recruiting and what is a good way to approach it? There's also some guidelines already in it. And this is already 5 years ago. And some advice when you want to proceed with your own career. For some, it might sound strange to be a craftsman the whole life. So they think they need to get a manager or whatever, or architect and so on. And here's also some thoughts about these parts. Mancuso, for example, himself, when he started in his career, he was a really good engineer, I would say. And then he was proclaimed to be part of the architect team. And he was doing it for 1 year, but at that time the architect team was really just architecting, caring about processes and not coding anymore. And he had the feeling to get out of touch. And therefore he went also to his manager and said, I want to become an engineer, a craftsman, a developer again. And yeah, of course his boss didn't understand, but this was what in the end lead for him to a nice career, to writing the book and establishing a nice successful company later on his own. So what's the current state? We heard that there was the Software Craftsmanship Summit, which was already in 2008, I think. And then there was the first Software Craftsmanship Conference, which was in UK, not in the US, which was in London, 2009. And from this conference, the first local groups evolved. So somehow the first one was in Israel, and the second one was, of course, in London from Sandro. And then we also shifted towards Germany. So in 2011, we had the first Socrates in Germany, I think 70 participants. Nowadays it's happening in Soltau every year. But besides that, there are a lot of other countries where there are also conferences happening 3 days with open spaces or sometimes just also a 1 day conference. Just that you know. Besides that, we have a lot of groups now. When you go to softwarecrafters.org, you can see a world map where you can scroll and dive into a lot of groups. So they have to sign up there on their own, so they are not all of them. But in general, we have on around 328 groups that are related to craftsmanship and 138k members. Maybe a bit more nowadays. I think I took the number roughly a year ago. But when you compare this still to Agile, what groups care about Agile and Agile methodologies, it's really small still. 1.5 million are somehow dedicated to Agile. As for myself, I founded one group in Jena, now called Software Craftsmanship Group Thuringia, but you see they are all around the DACH region. I think the closest one here is in Leipzig currently. Maybe some events have happened in Dresden, I don't know, but I think mostly in Leipzig from Andreas. Yeah. And yeah. So if you are interested, you can go there. This is just, and from my opinion, the things that I will talk to you here are not explicitly special for craftsmanship user groups. Of course, they have the focus, but still you can apply it at other user groups as well. So what are activities at these groups? Open space, everyone is maybe familiar with open space format, where you just come up with no agenda and then create one as the event is proceeding and you see what's coming up. Then there's also special sessions where you exchange about core topics, where you have a facilitator called Beards of Feather session. For example, Sandra in her user group were talking about branching strategies of Git. Lean Coffee is also possible, or Hacker Garden, where you contribute to other user to other open source software tools, and then the code retreat. This is not so what's so special, I think, about the craftsmanship user groups. It's some things that happened along the way, and this is what was also predominant in the past, I think maybe 5 to 2 or 3 years ago, also in London Software Craftsmanship Manifesto, and then Sandro said, okay, we should go back to the roots, because he analyzed some statistics and he realized that still every 2 years the amount of engineers worldwide is doubling. So many new engineers are still coming in, and of course when you run a craftsmanship or a community, you are so familiar with all the things happening there, and then you want to learn new things, so you talk maybe not so much anymore about TDD. Then you have a lot of new people coming in, and then you realize, oh, they still didn't hear about it. So you should start talking about these things again, so that the technical excellence level and how you create software is risen again. And what's also special about TDD is that it's really hard to acquire and easy to lose as a skill. And he realized it in a questionnaire that, yes, that TDD knowledge was going down again. Yes?
You have been talking about the regions, and showed the map, which was basically focused on Europe.
Yeah.
Do you know if there are some groups in the United States and in Asia also?
Yeah, in the US it's really common. So there are quite many groups, because some of the core leaders are from that region, of course. And in the Asian market, I'm not so sure, because this softwarecrafters.org website was delivered by a crafter from Berlin. And Raimo, of course, he provoked it. And he's also leading the global code retreat community. And so if there are new groups, they might sign in there if they find the page. I'm not sure. But in general, I would say that they are currently less in that region, at least in this map. So I'm going quite into international domain currently, but focusing also on Europe and US, so I'm not so sure about the Asian part, but I got some invites for India and Bangladesh, and in my experience, there might be a big need for it. They are really keen on learning, but they might be interesting. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, might be interesting. I mean, I was, for example, in Tallinn, just on a side note, there were also two people that said, okay, now we will establish some dojos in our company and try it. I'm not sure about the state. We were connected for some time and then, yeah. So, this is the current state, and now, yeah, curious, okay, what's then the core if I tell you these activities are also coming up along the side? So what has been predominant when you want to become a craftsman? What are the things that they do? So besides the manifesto, they came up with certain principles and they are reflected in the logo. So the first logo already had the four principles. You can see already individuals and interactions, which are also predominant in the manifesto, which means just that you learn from each other. So there is not per se a teacher or another master that could show you everything. So it's no classroom style. And also, of course, you want to create better software, well-crafted software, and therefore say that, okay, clean code is for us an important value. And to always improve, we should practice. So continuous improvement is important. And also still, when you talk to the guys that were starting this whole thing, they figured out that it doesn't stop. So for them, it's also a lifelong learning experience. As well, of course, our tools are evolving. So therefore, you know that there is no place where you can say, okay, I'm done. Who has participated in a coding dojo already? I am sure quite some have. Oh, 3-4 people. Okay, nice. So, what's a coding dojo? Here's, by the way, a picture of a coding dojo that I hosted with Marco in one of our first meetups. So actually, it's just a bunch of coders that get together to code, learn, and have fun. And Emily Bache named it to be, yeah, the bunch of coders coming together, it should be a winning formula. And it is not so strict as you might have at the university style, but it's really a more casual setup. And you see here already some people gathering about several laptops. Why should there be such a place like a coding dojo? The idea is we need a safe place. So there should be no managers, no deadlines, so safe. So they are especially excluded. Of course, it depends. So in one of the dojos that I hosted, there are two managers actually joined sometimes, but they really were keeping them to themselves and was, yeah, so they were just interested and also participating in coding, which I found really interesting because they were also engineers in the past. Ideas, also all professionals need to practice. This is the idea. And when you think about it, when you work on a project, you always deal somehow with a new feature, with something that should go live in the end. So it's more or less production code. It's also a nice analogy comparing to other craft disciplines. For example, take a musician. A musician needs to practice a lot. So he practices at home, maybe in some groups, maybe goes to a club or something before he performs on stage, right? Sometimes they even, if you would call practice, they practice in the streets to get some money before they go to stage. But the idea is that he is ready when he goes on stage to deliver great value. And there's an audience, and the audience are the customers. And what we do as an engineer, when we go from the university, we go directly into production land, and we are maybe not ready, and maybe we fail to deliver, and then we cannot handle all the challenges. And therefore, we need to create some space. So the coding dojo could be a place where people get together, but it could also be a place for you in your time box, on your weekly schedule, on a daily schedule, where you practice. And the idea is, of course, when you practice, not all forms, how you practice are equal. And I talked about their idea of delivering something like a coding school, right? Or developing schools, craftsmanship schools. And they figured out a special way how we could practice that should emphasize these skills that are so hard to acquire and easy to lose. So if you just think about it, often you develop some things and then it really doesn't go well and you do not make any progress besides reading a lot about bugs or whatever or on the internet. And they said, okay, we will take away you that burden. We will come up with some nice ideas how you can practice and also maximize the output of how you practice. And besides just creating the space, they also came up with some principles. So they are quite strict in some way. So the first rule already is that if you come up with a new design or something or code, then this code cannot be discussed at all without that there are tests. So you cannot show something to others if you don't have tests in place. But they are also aware that, of course, the people have different backgrounds, so everyone comes with their relics, and that you should have the mindset, even if you are long in the industry, that you need to learn again. And to free your mind, you should first get out of the stress, like also when you do it like at a retrospective, so you should slow down, and then you should also be passionate about it, so you should be open-minded, throw yourself in, and maybe find somebody who is good in something and learn from him, or just learn a subject. So have always a dedicated goal that you want to achieve when you start with something so that you don't lose track. I was talking about a lot about the space background and what do they practice? A kata. So a kata in general is coming from Japanese language, and it's just called form. And for them, a form was in a kata way is a detailed choreography, a pattern of movements that is just practiced over and over again. You can practice it alone in groups or as a unisonon when you train. And this idea of a kata was, of course, not just a normal movement, but also included then in some martial arts. For example, in karate, kata is really common, is the word for an exercise. Now, who is doing karate? Martial arts something? Ooh, okay. Usually there are some. So they could tell you a lot about how they approach this. And there are a lot of characteristics that you can transform from this to also programming, actually. This, I already told you the exercise, I can narrow it down a bit more. So what's an idea just that you practice alone or in groups is that exercise should be quite short so that you can incorporate it in such a dojo or in your daily life. So roughly 30 minutes to an hour. And also the content, it can be about programming, but there are also different types. So there are already some architecture katas, which are also nice, which can be solved in groups where you have more like a text, a little task, and then you come up and brainstorm how you could model in the end the architecture. Maybe use ARC42 or whatever comes to your mind. So this is also possible. What's currently not so predominant are like infrastructure as code cutters, which I would love to see more, but yeah, somehow people have not created them yet. So there's a spot if you want to do something in the next meetup here. Focus. So when we think about tackling something for production code, we always need to come up with a proper solution, right? Clean code and so on, right? But the point of a cutter or of this kind of movement when you create the code is not that you arrive at one perfect answer. So there are a lot of answers, and the thing is what's important is what you learn along the way. So the goal is to practice and not to find the perfect solution, because there will be many different solutions, also depending on how you approach the problem. One thing that is fixed, if at least when it's a programming cutter, is that you use test-driven development as a default pattern. Yeah, I'm not sure accurately how many cutters I've included, just outlined some. So for those who have not seen this, is there anyone who hasn't seen FISBUS? Okay, maybe the other question. Who has seen FISBUS? No. Okay, in general, this is one that is really quite more simpler one from the task that is given. So the idea is just that you print out numbers from 1 to 100. For multiples of 3, you print out FIS. For multiples of 5, you have to print out BUS. And for multiples of both, you print out FISBUS. So if you print it to command line from your program that you write, the output should just be this. And actually, this was a drinking game, right? In the 1960s, and it was described in an essay. But this was one of the ideas. And there are a lot of these arbitrary ideas that really evolved in programming, and where you now, when you search, you find thousands of different solutions. This is also something that is sometimes used for quick assessment with a new applicant or something. Other one is, for example, that we have the Roman numerals. So we just write a method like convert an integer into the representation in Roman numerals. So and then you could also print out numbers a lot, right? Or a string calculator cutter, which is, of course, just a calculator that you implement. And here's some more text what you can do. It's also by one of the first contributors to craftsmanship who came up with the idea. So for example, you could have first add method where you take in numbers just like 1, 2 numbers or 0, and then you check if the sum is correct. And then when the tests are passing, you refactor and make it more simple. It's already included here a bit in the description. And then you say, okay, now I take an arbitrary amount of numbers and so on, or add different kind of separators, new lines instead of commas, and then define a custom separator delimiter. And then also what happens if the numbers get negative, when I have a subtraction method, and so on. And what about the boundaries? When you have two big numbers, what happens? And there are different ways how you can solve it. I included here a video. I'm not sure if I want to show it now. I think I will skip this part. But here you just see that there are different ways. So if you are interested here, they are using preparatory refactoring, which actually is a bit different. So you have the test, and then you already have in the test the solution part, and then when you come up, it's a way where you produce a lot less code, but have the possibility to run the tests a lot more often, and you are longer in the green phase. Then another one is, for example, the diamond cutter, also quite popular. So you go through the alphabet, you start with the letter A. A is just, as output is just the A. And for the B, you get a small little diamond and a separator. So you could, for example, use underscores. And for a C, the diamond gets bigger and so on. For the E, you see what should be printed, right? And here's also a nice video how you can solve it. Besides that, there are many cutters that are focusing on daily life problems. The bowling game cutter, where you implement the bowling rules. You can also come up with a cutter where you find all prime factors, right? Then there's bank OCR cutter. Actually, I think we did it as a mob programming session, which was quite fun. First mob programming session in Leipzig at the CraftsmanShip user group. And yeah, and there are also some that are a bit more popular, like the Game of Life cutter. Let's see if I include it a bit more. Let me image. Maybe it's in the outtakes. Yeah. Ah, it's there. Okay. So anyways, what I want to tell you is that there are a lot of cutters. So if you want to try it and facilitate a dojo meeting, and just book a room, invite some people. And what I would recommend is that you do not push. So just invite people. So when I had some experience of the CraftsmanShip user groups, and when I established it in my company, for example, I just made it kind of inclusive. So my team, some were curious, so we said we will try it, and then we said everyone is free to come, and maybe, of course, just one or two people will join. But if it's a good mood and something that is a lot of fun, which you could realize, because at the next coffee breaks, there was a lot of chat about it, so I didn't do it, as I was not talking about it, but the others found the idea quite compelling and talked a bit more about it. And then when we hosted another one, the people that joined were a lot more already. So, and what I would recommend you as a facilitator is that you stay out of the solving process. And an idea is when you have a bigger group, we have no clue, for example, like here, what you would do is you would line up the people by their own experience. So they already have a nice chat. So they talk, okay, how much of TDD do I do in my daily life? And if you do a lot, then stay on this side. If you do just very few, then stay on the other side. And then like a scissor, you collapse it. And then you have the first pairs that work together on one machine. So it's important that everyone has their own, or one group or team has one laptop. Should be two people, could also be three if it's not even, of course. And you as a facilitator who comes up is just there like a scrum master and tries to create a good and healthy atmosphere, which means that the people that are participating, they should keep on coding. They should not just discuss. So the idea is that you don't just stop with coding. And yeah. Also, as a facilitator, you are not the trainer or something, right? So you are not the one who says, oh, and sees some errors that are happening, says, oh, this is not how I would do it. Let's do it like this or this, right? Of course, the people could reach out and say, hey, I'm not familiar here, and then they could ask something. But in general, let them make their mistakes. The best way to learn and get better. Let them mess up with TDD. And then when the coding part is over, for example, do a retro and let them discuss. So retros are really important. When we did a bigger one, like a full day, which is really, really nice, because they have several rounds and you see a fast benefit, because at evening activity, you can do one kata, for example, one round, maybe two, but then it's finished, is the format of code retreat. So it's just another place where people get together. You could do some introduction talk if you want about TDD and show it on the Beamer, how you would approach a problem, like live coding a kata, but it's not explicitly necessary. But you could then elaborate on some rounds. And as I said, they should be quite short, like 30 minutes, for example, or 40 minutes for coding. And then you have a retro of maybe 10 minutes, and then you have a short break before you start the next round. And the time will fly by really fast. And what I found interesting, and we did the first one, is, okay, it's on a Saturday. It's summer. So the people have the opportunity to go outside with their friends and family, go hiking or whatever, or come to the code retreat. And therefore I said, okay, I will make it easier. We will have beer. So at lunch, there was beer. And also the sweet flavor beer, like Radler, right? But what happened? I was the only one drinking one Radler. There was like 30 beers and there were 25 participants. And they were so enthusiastic. They said, no. Now I want to get better the next round. I cannot drink a beer now. It was really interesting. I didn't expect it because it was really hot, but somehow intriguing. Why was it so much fun? So it should be fun. Because there was the facilitator and they had new ideas every time we came up with new constraints. So we picked one kata, I will come to it later, which is really also something that is really somehow working really well and therefore used a lot at code retreats. So here you see the time boxes, even 45 minutes of coding to shorten the break, right? So first one is when you solve the kata is that there is no constraint, just that you apply test-driven development and that you work in pair programming. Driver navigator pattern should be something that is hard to learn when you maybe do it the first time, so that the driver is just hearing what the navigator is saying and implementing and not thinking on his own and doing stuff on the keyboard. But he has the keyboard, it's just coding. And he can already see that even if you are having a couple which is working usually in maybe different languages, this is also a nice way to learn another language, because when the driver knows, for example, JavaScript and knows how to write tests and so on, then you could say, okay, I just need a new function because it's an algorithm, right? And then you see already how it's done in other languages. And then when you swap, of course, the navigator can also say, write a function, and then it can help you. So you could here already see a benefit of getting knowledge about other languages, for example. So this is often already happening in session one, because maybe they're not all doing C++. You don't know, right? Here they might, of course, but you could say, okay, let's do the, so the language is not fixed for the kata. You choose it. When you get together as your group. And another one, we talked about clean code. And Ken Beck, he came up with something called the four rules of simple design. And they are quite compelling. So the first one is that all tests need to be clean. So passes all tests. It's really important when you implement something new. And another thing that you should also focus on when you think about the simple design is that clarity and intention should be really clear. So you don't have like short variable names like I or whatever, X, Y, Z, and so on, right? So that when you hand over the code to another team or to another person, which is that he still can maintain it and work on it. I see this a lot when I go to monoliths. Like I was working with a huge Perl monolith for some years, and it was a lot of code. And for me, there was a lot of duplication sometimes, so minimized duplication, and also long methods. So also has fewer elements. It's also something that he says: write precise code, not too many input parameters, and so on. Right? And these four things you could embrace. And how you could enforce it also in this session too, in this time box, is that, for example, after 30 minutes, two pairs are really performing well and they are getting close to finding some nice solution where they solve the kata and the output is as it should be and they are going on. And they say, okay, now we swap the laptop. Like laptop from one team goes to the another team. Yeah, it's called a code swap. And then you can really see if they are looking at these rules. What you could do, you can print them or hang them on the wall and always remind the people when you go around as a facilitator and you see, for example, a method that's really young, you can say, hey, is it for you really pure elements? Did you think about it? And just bring it to their mind again. It's also a nice book about it. You can get it on LeanPub. And another thing is that what we do when we start to write software is we don't go as often to a drawing board as we maybe should be. We think about, oh, there's a ticket. Okay, there's the code base. I know it. Let's just get together. Maybe we do pair programming already in the team, and then we just code along, right? And here you have a place to explore it. So what you could do as a facilitator is that the first 10 minutes are there for writing a test plan. Just write all the test cases that you think you might need to implement the solution, right? And in the retro, after that, you can discuss if the design, the software was evolving faster if you were just thinking on paper first and not just writing a lot of test cases, but also prioritizing them, finding an order for them. What should be the first one, the second one, and so on, which one is important, which one don't we need, and also see if it was possible to come up with all test cases, or if it wasn't, or if some test cases were too mushy, and so on, if they, when they went from the drawing board to the real code, if it was then easier to implement, and or some things were too much that were written, and in the end, if it was faster. Often, they are already implementing it for the third time, and I hosted this kind of session quite sometime already, and then they are faster, and they don't know why, even experienced engineers. And there you see it, and then somehow, maybe you will think about it in your daily life and say, okay, this time I will do it other way. And often, the last session, you could say, okay, choose a constraint that you want to have as a team. I will show you a catalog of more constraints in the next slide. Or you could say, okay, we do four constraints and you have to fulfill every constraint. So what are nice constraints that you can do while you practice with a team member? Besides driver navigator is ping pong. Ping pong is just that someone writes the test and the other person writes the implementation. And then you go ping pong. One is writing tests in one session and the other one is writing the implementation. There is, you can bump it up. Ping pong is the easy way. Then there is another constraint, which means that you cannot talk. I think it's not here directly, but so when you don't talk, is it still possible to communicate? And when you combine this with ping pong, then you can come up with mute with find the loophole, which means one person writes the tests and cannot of course talk. The other person is trying to find the loophole in the test. So he's when there should be a true or a Boolean value that should be given back, he's just saying, okay, I don't write any function body and just say, okay, when this function is involved or method, just return true. And of course, you might think about the problem and think, okay, there must be some logic, but you should let the other person enforce it in the test so that you get a good test coverage, for example, and the other person learns how to write a test. And this is also called evil programmer when it's with talking. You could also try to not use the mouse. Then, okay, I have an IDE. Do I know shortcuts? Can I get along with it? Use it just as a basic text editor, like whatever you like, Nano, Vim, Emacs, there are many, right? add, qadd, sed, whatever, right? Paper only is also interesting, maybe. Do you still know what methods to use? Or is it that you rely a lot on code auto-completion? When you think about all the types that you have, you could say, okay, I don't want basic primitives anymore, or there should be no conditional statements. So when you don't have conditional statements, can I still come up with a solution? Or when I don't have loops, so that you drive more into the direction of functional programming. And then it gets also interesting if you set these constraints, and the teams are always free to choose their programming language of choice, if they choose a language that also can handle these constraints, right? Simple ones like just 4 lines per method. So there are a lot of different constraints, and they are also like you can find them in certain categories. Yeah. Game of life, we will talk about it. And here you could also come up with specific constraints for a certain kata. For example, that when you write a certain object, that it should be a deployable unit. So that's what I mean with a microservice here. So that you already need to think about how can they communicate, so that you have them spinning up, and now we have Docker containers or and REST interfaces, or do I use messaging? Can I do this in a short amount of time? How familiar am I with the technology already? And the point is that you always discuss about it, and point is that you are open-minded, so that you are keen on learning, and you don't say, okay, it's really stupid, why should I use no conditionals? Because in normal production code, I would always use conditionals, of course, right? But the idea is that you learn, and you learn by getting new tools or taking tools away. And when you take away some tools, when everyone is just using the hammer all the time to hit the nail, it's maybe not the best solution. But when you take away the hammer for one time, maybe he finds that in his toolbox there are other tools that might also help. And these constraints can empower and emphasize to find and add new tools to your toolbox that you take to your client and to your project. So if you do a retro as a facilitator, what are the questions that you can ask? Of course, you do not need to ask every question, because retro is quite short, and some people have to tell a lot, some don't want to tell a lot. But what I think is really interesting is, are you happy with the design of the code that you ended up with? So you just have half an hour, and yeah, sometimes people are happy, but often they are not, especially when they then look at the constraints that they needed to fulfill. And also, you see a learning curve. So you could ask, did writing the test slow you down and how much? And you could ask if when you were developing, was there one or more threading tests at one time? So these are questions where you can already see really fastly or reveal if something is going well. And for me, an interesting point is also when you really take the TDD approach to your heart and write the test first implementation is, did you write more tests than you needed? And often you see, because of the refactoring steps, that you come up with the test design up front, and therefore you have the right amount of tests. That's what often happening. And you don't have a lot of blind spots. So, game of life. Who has heard about it? I think some, right. Okay, perfect. So I'll just elaborate shortly. So you have the ideas like in like bacteria cells, for example. There's one generation and the next generation. And when there's too many cells, then one cell is dying, and when there is the right amount of cells, the cell is surviving, and when it's a bit in between, then you have a new cell that is coming up. So this is just a kata that you could use for the coding dojo. And I've seen that many didn't do a coding dojo, but many have done this kata, or at least heard about it. So this is something that is, when you take in consideration all the possible constraints that are out there, and also different kind of programming, something that you could tackle. So the idea is also, when you do a kata, it's not you solve this one kata and then you go to the next one, but you solve one kata over and over again and apply all these constraints. Did you know that Game of Life is Turing complete? Maybe I showed some around. You know it? Okay, I will show just this for a second. Maybe. For those who don't know Game of Life, this is really interesting. How could the outcome look like? So you see here, when you visualize it, just like in a black and white, on a black and white board, you see that the cells are changing from each generation to the next generation, and it's getting bigger and bigger when we zoom out, and this is how your solution could look like. And the fun part is that the further we zoom out, there is a lot more to discover, and we also see that there are certain patterns that are occurring all the time. Actually, there is a wiki with patterns of Game of Life, like there are hundreds which are just coming up again and again. Like there's a spaceship pattern which is traveling from one side to another. And here now we zoom out so far that we already could see, aha, maybe these are also cells, the black ones, right? And the funny thing is now you see that they are also swapping. So you have the swapping in the small cells and also in the big cells. And here we see now how big patterns are moving across the board. And you can predict when they will reoccur. Okay, just a fun thing. This is something that you could show, for example, when you start a session. So, who is using TDT for a long time already? Some. Perfect. So I want to talk a bit more about it and also what kind of different aspects are there. So, okay, it stopped. Let's try. Here. So basic idea, I think it's clear to most of them. So first write the test, then make the test pass, and afterwards refactor. Why is it so hard? What is the goal of TDD? Actually, quality assurance is a minor point of TDD. Why the big point, or what's the plus of TDD, is that you think about the spec and the design, how your code should look like up front. And the quality assurance is just the benefit that you gain along the way. And also, you get a lot of living documentation. When you have a system that is having a lot of tests, you can see on the tests how should be the behavior of the software. And also when you come up with the design, you also find some kind of isolation points already where you can structure your software better and get a focus. And you should also try to do as small steps as possible. So write in baby steps. A lot of you might then also know the AAA pattern, Arrange, Act, and the Cert. There are also other ones that you could do. And this is the basic way how to do TDD. And this basic way, I would say, I would put it in the direction of the Detroit school, which is called the Classicists. So there you have really nice names. So the like Ken Beck and Uncle Bob, which are living near Detroit, where also the Software Craftsmanship Summit, no, the summit has happened first time. It was close to Detroit, just 30 miles away. So, and the idea is that you have a lot of state verification and you do not use mocks at all. Just when it's really needed, for example, for databases and third-party libraries in Javaland, at least, we also have now tools to get around mocking and the process boundaries, where you could use test containers, where we can spin up a sidecar container within our unit tests. And the sidecar container controls, for example, a database container, which we can set up to really act as a real, so it's a real database that is running there, and we do not need to mock it anymore. And there, the idea is to design from bottom up or from inside out, right? And the opposite approach is that you design from the outside to the inside, which is called the London School. And therefore, of course, when you go from the outside to the inside, you need a lot of mocking. And a special way to do this is the double loop acceptance test driven development. There you write first a failing end-to-end test, for example, for a REST endpoint. And then you write a corresponding failing unit test, for example, for a service method. Then you make the inner test pass, refactor it, and in the end, you make the auto test pass. And the whole idea is with the end-to-end test that it's tackling a deployable unit. And this is something which a lot might think, okay, sounds really interesting, but I never used it. Should I now use it when I tackle a new feature, right? I might take a lot more time. And therefore, such a dojo array for safe space is a nice idea to learn about it. And maybe you find others that already have done it, or you find others that are curious about it, where you could say, okay, we as a pair, we tried now this. It's more fun when you try it with somebody else, right? And the preparatory refactoring method that I showed you is basically a combination of or what I had the video included, which I didn't let run. It's basically a combination of both London and Detroit School. And we named it Munich School, we, Sandra and me, because yeah, we, the one that had the idea and came up with also some nice ways how to do it and talked about it at some conferences from Munich. So David names it as well, Fake It Outside InDesign. So you can Google it and then you can learn more about it if you want to. So he was practicing a lot. What else is there besides these three schools of test-driven development? There are, of course, the books that I showed you. And in the books, we see a lot of different examples about clean code. And one which you could also add as a constraint is a TDD as if you meant it. So in this case, there are three rules that you need to consider when you write software. First one is that you are not allowed to write production code unless it is to make a failing unit test pass. And you cannot write more of a unit test that is sufficient to make it fail, right? So you cannot say, okay, I will add in this unit test like five assertions, one after each other, and then I will write the implementation. So if you add the first assertion that is failing already, then you should go back to write production code. Or when it's a compilation failure, this also counts. And last one is that you cannot write more production code. So no more features or some things that you might need later, right? That are sufficient to make one failing test pass. And there should always be just one failing test. This is also something. Keith Brathwaite was talking a lot about it. So he's, for example, also from the US. And I think I'm sure he's one of the people at 8Light. So also Doug Bradbury was at 8Light. So from the HR manifest, software craftsmanship manifesto. So they are thinking about it and we're coming up with all these nice ideas and also with a lot of the katas that we can benefit now today from. Another one, Michael Feathers. I'm sure everyone has heard it at university. Have you? Solid principles. So often we do not think about it anymore. Here is a place where we can focus on it. For example, single responsibility. A class should just have one concern. It's so easy actually that often you do it, but then you come to a monolith and think about what the heck, who wrote this Scott class, right? And also open closed is really important. So if you want to extend something, it should be possible, but you should not be able to modify it and misuse stuff. Then we have the Liskov substitution principle. So you can always replace something with subtypes. One thing that for me was quite compelling when I saw some controller interface segregation. So you should have more general purpose or more specific interfaces in it, one general purpose interface. So I had one where it was like 15 input parameters, and then there was just like three, let's say, pages of parameter evaluation until something happened. And I don't know how they came up with this design idea. So in the end, I said, where are the tests? This was another failure. And another thing was that there was so much code and so much evaluation that I was really searching for the part where something was really then happening. Where was the invocation at least? And then I found out that they just took time to wrote all this evaluation part and there was no real invocation in the end. And there was just a to-do, right? And this is not how we should develop software, and it's not working software and not well structured. And therefore, maybe think more about having several interfaces that do specific things. Dependency inversion, so we should also try to use more abstractions than concrete implementations. So this is solid. There are a lot of examples, I think, when you go into this, and you could say, okay, let's focus on solid in one session. There are, of course, a lot of other ones. Don't repeat yourself. Don't implement something that you don't need. So that's what I told already at TDDs, if you meant it. Often you think, maybe later for the next sprint I'll need it. Don't write it, right? And also when you see some parts of software that are there and they are not used, they look cool and they do stuff, but you tackle a feature and implement it. Think about the Boy Scout rule that you should always leave a place more proper than it was before and just remove it. Do yourself a favor and get rid of this unnecessary complexity. Nowadays we have version control systems, so you can go back in time and get it anywhere, right? Yeah, KISS, of course. So in the end, my intention was that you should be keen on experimenting and find a place where you can do it. Maybe this is also an idea for the next event. Maybe you can do a kata together. Maybe as a mob programming session, if you just have a beamer and everyone is forgetting his laptop. Might also be a cool thing, I think, for a group. From my side, we are now coming to the end. I'm not sure if I have some outtake slides. No, not here, this deck, but you can find me if you are interested in following on Twitter, and here's my email address. I will post a link to the slides on the Meetup page. Thank you for participating. Yeah. Yeah, questions first.
Inside out. I'm curious about that one.
So here, what you would do is when you start to design software and you work with the Detroit School TDD approach is that usually you start at the inner parts, for example, writing first an entity, then writing it to the database, and then you come from the inner parts of the software to the outer parts, to the controller and so on, and to the interfaces. And this is often what you what is happening when you use the Detroit School approach.
The funny thing is that you often have exactly.
Yeah, I see the point. So what I would also try to recommend is to not just stick to one approach, but also try another approach and then measure and see which is faster, which is working better for most. And if you see that in your team or in your company, it's maybe just understandable by one person, right? This is also not a good sign for having clean code, which is easy to comprehend. And therefore, maybe just if you have the opportunity, which is a split task or another service, just try to develop it the other way maybe first and then mock the things that are inside, right? And could be beneficial, and then you could try it, and then if you have a space, and then you could show it to the others how you did it, make a short presentation or what, something like this. So I think it's experimental, and this is I would not confront. It's always not a good idea to confront the other person, say, hey, we don't get everything. Then, yeah, there's it's hard then to make an argument, because then you're going finger pointing. And I think the best way is to just do it as a sandbox and just try the other approach and then see if it works better for you or for most, of course. And maybe this is something that you could do in such a dojo or something. I don't know. Yeah, okay. More questions? Yeah. In hiring.
Yes, for example, or yeah, how why would I become a software
person? So yeah, okay. Yeah, okay. So first of all, there is no so we do not have like a guild where you get a certification, okay, now I'm a craftsman or no I'm not a craftsman. So often what we see when we look on Twitter, for example, is that people they write, okay, I'm a crafter, or others write, I'm an engineer, whatever. But if you write just crafters, that you have thought about certain things and are trying to follow these principles, first of all. So there is not a nice way to distinguish it, right? But if I would do an interview and it is like, probably there are some tasks to solve, or maybe there's a probation day where you just invite the person to the team and then see if he fits. You need to align to some quality criteria, right? And one is, of course, if he's writing code that is also easy to understand for the others. And therefore, there should be some principles applied. And some of them are mentioned here, which are at least improving the design and which are producing a more maintainable software artifact. So therefore, I think if you have in your team a mindset like this established, it's much easier for you to come up with solutions that are longer maintainable and lasting. And what we did, for example, in my last company where we had several teams, so we said, okay, every 2 weeks, so at one day in the sprint, we take 6 hours off where we just present what we have learned in the sprint. and it was for three teams, and everyone was invited to join, also other teams if they wanted. And we presented in maybe just by showing in the code base or by also making small presentations what we learned. And we talked first with the managers or product owners if it is possible that we could establish this for us, because it of course goes on the business hours, but they were like open to it. And what they found out is that when one team now introduced a new feature, like for example the Helm templating, it was a really nice spot that we already had where we don't need any discussion with anyone, hey, we want to show it. It was already set up, so there was the space. You could just add it on the wiki to the agenda for the next event or whenever you wanted to present it and then show it. And the others could learn from it and benefit from it and implement it in their parts of business area where they maintained it or in their services. And this mindset extends beyond just the 9-to-5 job as well. So what's actually also written from Sandro is that when you compare it to musicians, a musician is paid when he's on stage, right? But he's not paid at the time he's practicing, right? And why should we be paid when we work in the company where we produce production code? So we should be the ones that take the responsibility to push our own level forward to deliver better software. And what you could negotiate is if you are better in delivering software, if it is then worth to reduce your amount of working time in a shorter time box, because you are more productive and the outcome has a good quality. In the current company, they, for example, said, okay, we also are keen on that mindset, and therefore we just have 4 working days, and one day is like in the Google model, an additional day where you have working time, but it's up to you what you want to do with it. So if you want to dive into learning more about TDD, you know, about cloud technologies or whatever, right? Write articles, go to a meetup and talk. Or so some employers, they realized how beneficial it is and how it also helps to deliver better customer projects. And even from my experience, currently I'm at a consulting company, so I work directly with clients. If you explain the model to them, when you get a new contract, where they hire a team, for example, or just several engineers, it's quite easy for them to align to it. Many companies don't do it, but it's not like they say, okay, then you're working less than other companies. You're just working 4 or 5 days every week, so we just get 4 days of software from you. But somehow they really understand it and see that therefore we can deliver new things, for example, that others don't have time to learn. But in general, it's up to you. So, and I think you already do it in a kind of way because you go to user group. I'm sure no one is paid to be here. I think so. So, and therefore I would always try to hire the other person. If there is a higher salary, I don't know. This depends on the contract negotiation. Yeah. It depends on what the customer is, but if you think about the customer as the user, I would doubt that he just wants to be something that is barely usable or something that is nice to use but he enjoys to use. So, and then the product owner or the company that you work for, they might also say, okay, maybe we just need a certain feature set. That is more what I would say. And you could say, okay, I'm delivering a nice feature set, so everything is working. And maybe you are just like, when he wants to add another feature, you are faster to change it because you're applying certain principles so that it's better maintainable or something. And I think also the mindset should not be that it's the responsibility of the client to demand from you to write great software. Because I'm sure most clients don't care about software at all. So they don't care what language you use. Also, why should they? They have a certain business goal that they want to achieve, certain business value that they want to deliver, have delivered, and that's what you need to put into the table. And therefore, it's really good when you have well-crafted software, because then you should be able to really respond faster and write. And so this is also the best way to introduce it, leading by example and just be open and not pushing it. Maybe there's also a nice analogy like writing books, right? Books just consists of words. A software just consists of code. But somehow some books are more popular than other ones. And most often these are the ones that are more well crafted, where the phrasing on the words are chosen more carefully, where there's a certain style that is there, and somehow it's more compelling, and people, they get addicted to this book and read the first book and then the next book of the author. And I think this is something that we could take as an example for our software code. So maybe it should be like a nice roman that you want to open again and want to look what you've done like 1 year ago or something, right? Yeah, sure. So, of course, when you just produce clean code and you don't hit the end goal, so add the business value, then it could be really, crazy. It's also said that the Agile Manifesto was there to do the right things, and the Craftsmanship Manifesto is there to do the things right. So you need both parts.
Okay, thank you again.